Hey everybody, how's everybody doing today? Welcome back to another Tuesday night tune-up in the Word of God. And listen, we got an exciting lesson for you tonight. So sit back, get your Bible out, because I'm going right back talking about putting on the full armor of God. But I'm going to talk about one piece, and we talked about that one piece on last time that we had our lesson on this. Was talking about the sword, which is the Word of God. And you know what I did? I went on Amazon and I went out and found a what they call a gladius sword. And actually, during Roman times, swords been around a long time. And there were three types of swords. I won't try to go into it tonight, but there was one specific sword that was used by the Roman centurion soldiers with the gladius sword. And that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. And the lesson is tagged, A Weapon of War, A Weapon of War. Let's pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you tonight for another Bible class. And you have given us and given me, Lord, so much insight, so much revelation in the Word of God about the sword, which is the Word of God. And I pray tonight that the saints, those who are watching and listening, Lord, by streaming our lesson out there to them, that they will glean something from this lesson tonight to help them to walk, give them the victory, give them, Lord, what they need to continue to walk in the goodness and the fellowship of your love and kindness. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's start. Our foundation scriptures, number one is Ephesians 6 and 17, it says, and take the helmet of salvation, we covered that, and the sword of the Spirit, notice, which is the Word of God. Now, we talked a little bit about that in our last lesson, the sword of the Spirit, but I got so heavily engrossed and my interest grown so much about the Word of God or the sword of the Spirit, I went for more. I dug some more stuff out, and I found so much, and that will help us, amen, to live a victorious life and keep the enemy and our opposer, our accuser, under our feet. All right, here it is. Hebrew, the 4th chapter, verse number 12. Now get this one. You got to get this down. Hebrew, the 4th chapter and verse number 12. Notice, for the word of God is quick, is powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit and the joints of marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Now, notice, Apostle Paul gives a clear picture using the analogy of the armor of a Roman soldier. You know, Paul was more or less like a jailbird, if you want to say that. He was always in and out of prison. He was always around soldiers being bound. And God, the Holy Spirit, amen, just touched him and gave him a revelation about the Roman soldiers and the armor that these guys had on. And them Roman soldiers, they were ruthless guys. But Paul saw something in that armor, and he compared it to us as believers, that we got to have armor because we are facing, or we're all going to face, battles. Not only battles, but they will be spiritual battles. And so to be in these battles, you got to put your war clothes on. And anytime the Roman soldiers went to war, they went to war with battle clothes on. And that's why they were successful, because they had the right pieces. They had the right things on. And they knew, they were. Let me say this, they were skillful. I read chapters and pages where the Roman soldiers were skillful in battle. They were not only skillful, but they were trained to be skilled in battle. In other words, they were skilled in using their sword, which is called the gladius. Now, man, I'm kind of taking off already because this is so good tonight. So our study would deepen us, and we will find more revelation in the word about the word being a powerful, the Hebrew writer said powerful, that the word of God is powerful. And so we're going to try to bring that out tonight if we have time. It's a powerful weapon in the believer's life. You hear that again? The word of God is a powerful weapon in a believer's life. Okay, you need to hashtag that. You need to put that in the comments, that the word of God is a powerful weapon in my life. So the sword is a tool in the believer's hand, and it is the weapon of offense. Now, if you notice that there were six pieces that Apostle Paul mentioned in his analogy of talking about the armor of the soldier, six pieces. Now, five of those pieces were defense. They was used for defense, or another word be used with for their protection. The helmet, protection. The breastplate, protection. Shod his feet with the preparation of the gospel. It was for protection. All those pieces were for the soldier's protection. But there was another piece, which is the sixth piece, and the sixth piece was used as a offense. Offense. You got defense, you got offense. Now, what's good to have a defense and you don't have offense? You like anything like in sports, you can have a good defense, and you should have a good defense, but also you got to have some offense. And so you be prepared when you go to battle. Now, if you look at this word offense, offense means striking against. Striking against. Now, I haven't picked up this sword, but this is the sword that a Roman soldier would use. Now, the only thing about this, it's not sharp. See, I can run my hand across it and wouldn't cut it. But if this was sharp, then a two-edged sword, I could just touch the blade and it would just be so razor sharp, it would cut me. And notice that it was always about maybe about 16 to maybe 18 inches long. And it was a reason for that. Also, you'll notice that it had a V-type point on it, a V-type point, because Roman soldiers, they would do their battle up close, hand-to-hand combat. They was up close, one-on-one. And it was used not just to slash, you know, but it was used to thrust. Remember that? To thrust their opponent, to thrust at their enemy. Let me move on. So now when the devil strikes against you, you got to have a weapon to do what? Strike back. Remember that, strike back. And let me say this, digress. Many believers today, some don't know how to strike back. And only way you can strike back at the enemy, you must have the word of God. Let me read on a little bit more. Somebody say strike back. Put in the comment, strike back. Learn how to strike back. Let me give you an illustration of that. If you'll find in Matthew, the fourth chapter, verses 1 through 11, you can see two things in there, maybe three things in there. One is you will find where the enemy came against Jesus when he was fasting. He struck at Jesus, and he came at Jesus, right? And Jesus struck back at him. It is a war. It's spiritual warfare. Don't you think just because you got the Holy Ghost and the Spirit of God and you can run all over the church and get happy and the devil will not strike at you? Let me tell you, as soon as you come off that spiritual high, he will strike. As soon as you come off that spiritual hype that you have, amen, he's coming at you. And if he don't come at you, he will strike at your finance. He will strike at your marriage. He will strike in your home, your children. Let me tell you something. He's a dirty soldier. He's a dirty fighter. He don't care. But you got to wise up and know how to to use the weapon that God has given you and strike him back. All right? Strike him back. Now, notice this. Matthew 4 chapter. The tempter, the devil, tempted Jesus to do what? To eat bread. He tempted him to eat. Because now, you know, he's been fasting 40 days. And so he's tempting him with physical food. Okay? Now, he asked him the question. If, now you got, that's where you got to be careful. Anytime the devil comes at you and say, if, you better watch out. If he says, if, you better get on your P's and Q's. If he says, if, you ought to start running. If he says, if, you better stand up and be ready to strike back. He said, if you are the Son of God, okay? And sometimes the devil, he will do that. Are you really a Christian? If you really a saint, if you're really righteous, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? He asked that question. If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Now watch what Jesus said. Jesus said this, it is written. Now notice, three times that the devil tempted Jesus, and every time he came to Jesus, he gave him an if, and then Jesus responded by saying, it is written. In the word of God, he said, it's written that man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. So the way he defeated the enemy in his life, that particular circumstances, by the word of God. And Paul, what Paul did was he made that analogy that the word of God is like a sword. A sword. Somebody say a sword. The devil will come against you, your family, your finances, your health, your body, your marriage. I mean, it goes on and on. And he don't care. If you was to call up Job, Job had to deal with that. Amen. He had to deal with the enemy striking at him. Notice one thing. You have a very powerful weapon. This word of God is a weapon. It's powerful. You got to use this tool. And many times, the reason why the enemy gets the best of us, because a lot of times we do what? You lay down your sword. You lay down your weapon. And Roman soldiers always kept their weapon by their side. Matter of fact, it was on the right side of that belt that they had. Keep your word. Study the word. Meditate in the word. Amen. Get up with the word. Go to bed with the word. Memorize the word of God. Repeat scriptures and scriptures and scriptures over again. Amen. Because it is a weapon and a force and a powerful force against the devil. Amen. And Jesus showed it in that illustration that after Jesus kept on saying, man, can I put it in my own word? Devil, listen, man, it's written. It's written that man shall not live by bread alone. It's written, no weapon formed against him shall prosper. It's written, he was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquity, and the chastisement of peace was upon him. I'm healed. When he strikes, amen, with sickness and strikes with disease, you strike back with the word of God and let the devil know that God is Jehovah Rapha. He is my healer. COVID-19, cancer, whatever sickness, amen, you got to know how to stand on the word of God and you know, let me put it like this, know the word of God, use the word of God, and strike back and push the devil back when he come and bring them thoughts to your mind. Strike back with the word of God. I hope you are getting something out of this tonight, because this lesson itself is just so powerful. Let me go on. Let me finish up here. Now, Roman soldiers were not afraid. I'm going to say it again. Roman soldiers were not afraid to go to battle. You can't, let me say this, Christian believer, you cannot be afraid to be in a battle. Whether you want to be in the battle or not, when you enlisted in God's army, amen, you was enlisted in a battle, because battles will come, but it's already been laid out that God has already given you the victory. He already given you the armor, and you're going to come out victorious. No wonder Paul said, thanks be unto God who giveth us the victory through Jesus Christ. You got to use what Christ used, and Christ used the word of God against the devil. So you got to pick up your armor, use it, and strike back at the devil, okay? They were trained. They were highly trained. They just didn't go out to battle, but you will find that they would have training. They would take wooden swords about the same size, and they would have wooden posts out there, and they would just strike and thrust and strike and thrust. Why? Because they got to feel the weight of the sword, amen. You got to understand that you got to be skilled. You don't have to be a preacher. You don't have to be an apostle. You don't have to be a prophet, amen, to be skilled in the word of God. All you got to do is have a love for God's word and love, amen, reading the word, love studying the word, love. And you know what? Out of that, what's going to happen? You're going to be skilled handling the word of God. And it's a psalm. I look at some Christians, sometimes they only pick up their sword when, on Sunday morning. That's when they pick up their Bible on Sunday morning. Haven't read it all week. Haven't looked up a word all week. Haven't read a chapter or a verse or meditate on the word of God. Never have applied the word of God in their life or anything like that. But on Sunday, you know, they're there flipping the pages and trying to see what the preacher's saying and their pastor's saying. But if you want to be skilled, if you want to be skilled in the word of God, amen, then you got to get in the Bible, and then you can become skilled in handling the word of God. I would advise preachers and teachers and Sunday school teachers and people that are teaching home Bible class, get in the word so you can be skillful, amen, in handling the word of God. Roman soldiers, they were skillful. I love watching those movies and how those guys swing and how they know what to hit and how they know how to thrust, know how to handle their shields, amen. But they was powerful with it. They were skillful with it. And they could take out their opponent at any time because they were trained to do it. We got to be trained. And a lot of times you'll find when we receive salvation, we don't want to be trained. How do you be trained? By coming to class, coming to Bible class, going to Christian education classes, amen. Sitting up under somebody that's already skilled in the word of God, so you know how to do what? Rightly divine the word of God. And there's so much error out here, so much heresy, so much things that's being said out here, and you got to be able, amen, to strike back with the truth. And that's another thing that's a part of the word. The word of God is truth. And there are so many people out here today. It's so many doctrines and so many teachings out here today. And if you do not ground it in the word, let me back up and say, if you're not trained in the word, you know what will happen? You'll pick up some false doctrine. You'll pick up some false teaching. And then what happens, amen, you'll find yourself being a shipwreck. That's what the old timers used to say, that you become a shipwreck. But you don't want to be a shipwreck, but you want to be highly skilled in the word of God. And I know in some cases we would love to go to a Bible college or love to go to a seminary school, things like that. And some of you are very privileged to go to a Bible college or a Christian college or whatsoever, amen. But if you're not able to do that, still you can get a dictionary. You can get a Bible dictionary. You can get so many good commentaries out there and study. You have a good pastor. You have a good man or woman of God that's astute in the word that can break it down with you. Good teachers in Christian education that you can set at their feet and you can learn. I think about young Timothy. And that was one thing that Paul noticed in Timothy. He knows that you got a good foundation laid in you. You already had some good pre-training in the word of God. Who did it? He noticed that it was Timothy's mother and Timothy's grandmother had put a foundation in the Word of God, for him to know the Word of God at an early age. And that's why Timothy was so successful, amen, when he came to, when Paul picked him up, amen, Paul just kind of put the finishing touches on him so he can be highly skilled. And you want to be highly skilled. I know somebody by the name of, some of y'all probably heard Elder Johnny James. They call him the Walking Bible. I remember Bishop Paddock and the PFW. These guys, man, these guys were highly skilled in the Word of God. Let me tell you something. You may not believe it. You may not believe it. They would study the Word of God so much, they hid the Word of God in their heart. So when it came out, they wouldn't even have to pick up the written word. They could quote the written word, amen, verbatim for verbatim, amen. They can say the thus. They wouldn't miss the and. They wouldn't miss the thou. They could say it. They could tell you what chapter. They could tell you what verse. I mean, from front cover to the back cover. And that's why they were called the Walking Bible. And honey, let me tell you something. When it got it like that, the enemy won't come around you that much. The enemy will probably see you coming. He'll probably run. That's why the Bible says, resist the devil and he shall flee. Let me read on. So don't be afraid to go to battle. And you ain't got to be afraid to go to the battle when you're trained for war and when you're trained to use the sword which is by your side. And when I think about the sword or the Word of God by my side, that's Christ. Because Christ is the Word, and he's by your side. The Word by yourself, or the Word is by yourself, you can strike back and take out the enemy. Remember that, take out the enemy. Now, your offense is the Word, or the sword is the Word of God. Now, let me say this. Not only it is a weapon of offense, but Paul tells you how deadly it is in a battle, in a battle. Now, let me go back. Hebrews 4:12, notice this, highlight this. For the Word of God, notice, is quick, it's powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. Okay, notice, piercing, 1, 2, dividing, 3, it's a discerner, all three. Okay, and we're going to get to that in a few minutes. But let me take care of this. I hope I can get this in before our time is up. Notice that the Hebrew writer says, two-edged sword. The Holy Ghost singled that out to me, the two-edged sword. Now, there were some swords in the Roman times was just sharp on one side of the blade, on one side. Then there were the Roman soldiers. They had two-edged blades, which were sharp on both sides. Now, there is revelation in that. Catch it now. Two sides, both sides are sharp, but one blade. We're going somewhere with this, okay? The blade of this sword is sharp on both sides, and notice that it could penetrate and cut at every contact point with every movement. And this sword is like a dagger. It has to be used up close on the enemy and his forces, the opposer, up close. It wasn't for slashing. Now, there were other swords were longer than the gladius sword, and it was mainly used for thrusting. You know, you may just skim or cut, slash, or maybe use the word slash, it was for slashing. But when you use the gladius sword, it was used for thrusting the enemy. And when it thrusts, it's gonna cut. And I was reading somewhere in the Roman soldier said, if they thrust it, and if it hits you on the side or in your heart, all it would take would be 2 inches of this sword or 2 inches of this blade, and it would do heavy damage. Think about that. Just 2 inches of the blade is so sharp on both sides, and notice that it's pointed and is used like a dagger to thrust at the enemy. In just 2 inches, it would do heavily damage at the enemy. Can you imagine that this being used? I better be careful. And that's a point, too. You got to know how to handle the blade. You got to know how to handle the sword, because it can help and you can bring harm. And a lot of times I hear people say, boy, that word you preach, man, it hit me. It hit me. Yeah, but let me tell you something. Before it hits you, the word of God is hitting me, too. Because why? It's a two-edged sword. It's a two-edged sword. So this means that it can be thrust more quickly and deeply and cut more easily, okay? The two-edged sword, I got to stop right here, but the two-edged sword is a two-edged sword referring to two mouths. If you look that up, two mouths. Let me throw this in real quick. If you notice, amen, a two-edged sword is referring to two mouth. So you guys speak the word. Now, how do I speak the word? I'm going to stop right here for tonight. But this is how it's done in a short form. You got the written word on one side, and you got the rhema word on the other side. The only way that the written word, which is the quickened word, will come forth, that you got to know the written word. Let me back up. Maybe you get it. If you know the written word, meditate on it, love it, study it, and all that, then you will find in the time of a battle that whatever you got in your reservoir is going to come up quick to be used in the battle. Okay, just like a computer. Anything I type into this computer or, you know, in my files, boom, 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 I can look it up, it's there. But if I don't put it in my files, I don't have nothing to go back on, because nothing is there. And many Christians are like that today. They are in battles, but they don't know how to fight. They're not skilled in the word of God. And one thing I've learned, you got to use the right word. Here it is, the right word for the right battle. I feel the Holy Ghost on that. You got to know how to use the right word, the right scriptures, the right chapter in the right battle. Because all battles are not the same. The devil will strike your health. Well, you can't go back and go in the scripture and find something about money when you got some stuff going on with the doctor told you that this is going on in your body and all that. Then you got to find some scriptures about healing. You got that? So you got to know how to fight and use the right scriptures in the right battle. Yeah, okay, maybe my health is good, but now, you know, I need some bills paid. I lost my job. Then you got to use the right scripture, come on, in the battle, that you know that the Lord will supply, right? All of my needs according to his riches and glory. Why? Because I know the word of God. If I didn't know the word of God, I have nothing to pull out to strike back at the devil. Listen, there goes my time. My time is up, and I got to stop for the night. But this is so good, and we're going to continue on with this lesson, the weapon of war. All right, the weapon of war. Listen, join us on this Friday night. We're going to have a special guest who's going to come in and be with us. I won't tell his name right now, but he's going to plan to be with us all the way from Chicago, Illinois. And he's going to be with us, and we're going to be talking about ministry in the pandemic. And then on Sunday at 10:30 a.m., we're going to have parking lot service on the parking lot. Bring your lawn chair. Pull up on the parking lot. If you don't want to get out of your car, you can sit there right there in your car, and we're going to have service right there on the parking lot. We're going to have our praise team, and our singers going to be outside. Everything that we do on the inside, we're going to do on the outside. And the amazing thing, my podium and my pulpit, my stage is going to be the rooftop of the church. I'll be preaching from the rooftop of the church. It's going to be a dynamic time, have a great time. We have security out here. We have the men out here. We're going to have a great time in the Lord. And I love to see you come out. Oh, let me tell you this before I dismiss you. Man, we had a great time on Pentecostal Sunday. I don't know if you heard the report, but on Saturday, we hit the streets. We were out on the streets, and we were praying for people. Cars was coming up, had about 25 cars. We prayed for men and women and children. People on the street received prayer. And I tell you what happened, that on Sunday morning, some of those souls came back to the church on Sunday morning. And guess what? We baptized 4 in Jesus' name. And before the day was out, one got the Holy Ghost. Come on and give God praise. Come on and give him praise for the souls are coming in. The harvest is ripe, my friend, but the laborers are few. I thank God for Greater Pentecostal, amen, for laboring out there. And you saw the fruits of the labor, amen, Pentecost Sunday. So we're going to go outside again and let's pray. Let's fast. Let's just believe God going to do some great things out here in the parking lot and souls to come up and get saved and get filled with the Holy Ghost. That's what I want to see. Amen. People get saved. And listen, amen, if you want to give something, amen, to this ministry by Giveify, Cash App, you'll see it ran across the stream. And we're so thankful that you tuned in all over the United States, that you're watching by Roku and SOV Saints of Value Network. We want to thank them for allowing us to have this platform to be on their network. So to see you again, we will see you Tuesday, Bible class tune-up. God bless you in Jesus' name. All right, Justin.
Yeah.
You didn't fell asleep.
Did you finish?
Yep.